Good evening. You're watching the news at 7:30 on ATV. I'm Emily Su.
And I'm Joyce Wu. Here's a look at tonight's top stories.
Police arrest a man after finding bodies of two women, one a foreigner, in Wan Chai flat.
Tsang Yok-sing shoots down call by Benny Tai for dissolution of LegCo if reform bill is rejected.
Two banners in support of real democracy removed from Shan and Kowloon Peak. A foreign man has been arrested as police launched an investigation into the murder of two women whose bodies were found in a flat in a luxury Wan Chai building.
After finding one victim, it took officers another 8 hours before discovering the body of a second woman in the suitcase. ATV's Arthur Kula reports.
The bodies of two women found dead in a flat at a plush building in Wan Chai were taken away this afternoon as police continued their investigation into the double murder. Police were called to J residence on Johnston Road at around 3:45 a.m. after receiving a call about a murder in a flat there. A foreign woman in her 20s was found with cut wounds to her throat and was declared dead at the scene. Officers said a blood-stained knife was found nearby. A 29-year-old foreign man who had telephoned police was arrested in connection with the murder. Police said the suspect knew the victim. 8 hours later, during a search of the premises, officers found the body of another woman sticking out of a suitcase measuring 1 meter by 1.5 meters. The second woman had neck injuries.
The condition is that we believe that the body had been found dead for quite some time. And then the pathologist will conduct the autopsy later on so that we will find out the cause of death at a later time, but not now.
Police said the body was found on a balcony, and it took them a long time to discover it because they had to follow strict procedures.
I'm an empathizer that because of a serious crime scene, we must follow this our investigation step by step. The more important is to get the various evidence and also to make sure the scene is not tampered. So we follow our normal procedure in the scene of serious crime.
The nationalities of the suspect or the victims have not been revealed. Arthur Rakiola, ATV News.
Occupy Central leader Benny Tai says the Legislative Council should be dissolved if lawmakers reject the government's political reform package.
But LegCo President Tsang Yok-sing shot down the idea, saying it will not help ease or end the current political stalemate.
With lawmakers becoming increasingly polarized, the chances that they will reject any government political reform package next year are growing by the day. This morning, the man behind the Occupy Central movement said if and when this happens, the chief executive should dissolve the entire legislature. According to Benny Tai, Hong Kong's top leader is empowered to act in such a manner under Article 50 of the Basic Law. The Hong Kong University lecturer said disbanding LegCo would pave the way for a new set of elections that could be regarded as a de facto referendum on Beijing's tight framework for the 2017 chief executive election.
It has the element of a referendum, even though it may not have the name of a referendum, in which a major issue or a controversial issue will be decided by all eligible voters together.
Tai hinted that fresh elections could break the current political stalemate. For more than a month, demonstrators calling for greater democracy have blocked main roads on both sides of the harbor. And there are no signs that student leaders and the government will hold another round of talks.
If the chief executive has this commitment to solve the problem we are now facing by using this Article 50 procedure, I think it will have a chance to resolve the present conflict.
Democratic Party chairwoman disagreed with Tai.
I think the procedure for passing the electoral package is contained in the Basic Law Annex, and it does not contain a clause saying that if the package is voted down by the Legislative Council, the Chief Executive may dissolve the Council. I think if that is the intention, it would have been written there.
LegCo President Tsang Yok-sing isn't optimistic about Tai's idea.
I do not see any reason why the Chief Executive should do so. What productive, positive consequence can come from such an act by the chief executive? I don't see any reason at all for doing that.
Tsang said even if chief executive Leung Chin Ying dissolves LegCo, the composition of the incoming legislature will not change significantly. And should the PAN Democrats manage to snap up more seats, Tsang said that wouldn't necessarily mean the public is against the government's proposals. Earlier this week, student leaders suggested that opposition lawmakers should resign to trigger by elections that would enable voters to express what they feel about the tight restrictions Beijing imposed. Several lawmakers support the idea, calling it the next step in their civil disobedience campaign, although nothing has been set in stone yet. Former Liberal Party chief James Tian, meanwhile, reminded protesters that Beijing will not change its mind on political reform. Tian was expelled from China's top political advisory body this week after calling on Leung to step down because of his inability to end the Occupy crisis. The lawmaker said his expulsion showed that China will stick to its hardline formula and will not be swayed by protests.
Two more massive banners supporting the pro-democracy movement have been removed just hours after appearing on peaks in the city.
No one has claimed responsibility for the banners that were hung on Tai Mo Shan and Kowloon Peak. ATV's An Chang reports.
8 days ago, people in Kowloon Tong woke up to see a huge banner supporting democracy hanging from Lion Rock, one of Hong Kong's landmarks. That banner was removed, but two more were seen today. This time on Kowloon Peak and Tai Mo Shan, the city's tallest mountain. The message was the same: I want real universal suffrage. The banners, which were put up overnight, also bore the image of an umbrella, the symbol of the pro-democracy protest campaign. Firemen removed both banners today. An attempt to take down the one on Kowloon Peak last night was abandoned when it became too dark. They abseiled down the slope and removed it. But unlike the first one on Lion Rock, it took longer because the banner was hung in the middle of Kowloon Peak, making it harder to reach it. The Agriculture, Fisheries and Conservation Department said it will prosecute those responsible if it has sufficient evidence. Police said whoever did it may have violated the Country Park Ordinance and could be fined up to $2,000 and jailed for 3 months if found guilty. It's not known who was responsible for putting up the latest banners. A group known as Hong Kong Spidey claimed responsibility for the Lion Rock display. It said it didn't put up the latest banners today, but was glad someone did so. Protesters in Admiralty reacted to the removal of the banners by creating one drawn in chalk on a small section of Harcourt Road. An Chang, ATV News.
Fears of a health threat at protest sites rose today when a person in Admiralty was confirmed to have contracted pneumonia.
As tensions mounted on the 35th day of the sit-ins that have paralyzed parts of the city, one man threatened to jump off a building in Mong Kok to underline his opposition to the Occupy campaign.
There was drama in Mong Kok this afternoon when an opponent of the pro-democracy protests threatened to jump off the ledge of a building on Nathan Road. Police cordoned off the area while demonstrators moved their makeshift tents to clear the path for firefighters. A large inflatable cushion was put in place as a precaution. Police made several attempts to persuade the man to give up. After about an hour, he re-entered the building helped by officers. Thanks to you guys, I no longer have a job, but I have a family to feed. The man admonished demonstrators as he was wheeled out on a stretcher. Don't you have families too? The man is a familiar figure in Mong Kok and has been seen arguing with protesters while trying to remove barricades. The drama did not halt a cleanup operation in the usually congested district. Protesters tidy up their occupation site amid concern of poor hygiene in the other two demonstration zones, Admiralty and Causeway Bay. Health Chief Koeing Man this afternoon confirmed that a protester who has been camping out in Tamar was diagnosed with pneumonia. The victim is being treated at Queen Mary Hospital, but Koe could not say where or how he contracted the disease. The Food and Environmental Hygiene Department has been monitoring the cleanliness of all occupied sites since the street blockades began, and staff have provided cleaning services in the area they have access to. In a related development, three more bus companies have filed a writ with the High Court for an injunction to clear sections of Harcourt Road, Connaught Road Central, and Cotton Tree Drive. The court earlier granted and extended three injunctions filed by minibus and taxi companies, requiring protesters to leave some occupied zones in Admiralty and Mong Kok. But the court order has been ignored so far.
Police have arrested more than 300 people since the mass protests began in late September.
The tally included one person who was detained in Mong Kok overnight in clashes that erupted after an opponent of the demonstrations visited a protest hotspot. Here's Arthur Akila.
Tensions ran high as Patrick Koh, who heads one of the most prominent anti-Occupy groups, visited Mong Kok at around 2 a.m. The Voice of Loving Hong Kong chairman was surrounded by demonstrators who accused him of trying to stir up trouble. Koh was escorted by police to a nearby van. But protesters confronted officers on the other side of a cordon, accusing them of protecting Koh. Two officers were injured in the scuffles that followed.
A 35-year-old man assaulted one and pushed another officer onto the ground. The man was arrested for assaulting police.
The suspect was taken away while the two officers were sent to Kwong Wah Hospital nearby for treatment. Police warned demonstrators not to confront officers.
We do not want to see anyone, especially students, being hurt when they place themselves close to the radical individuals and troublemakers during the violent acts. When police officers are executing their duties on the ground, protesters, in particular students, should not put up resistance. They should stay calm and maintain a safe distance.
Since the protests began 35 days ago, police have arrested 319 people. About a dozen others were detained for suspected cybercrimes. Arthur Urquiola, ATV News.
Industry representatives have continued to complain about a massive loss of business because of pro-democracy sit-ins.
Hotels say bookings have plunged. Retailers near protest areas claim turnover dropped by as much as 70%, and the Halloween crowd in Lan Kwai Fong was smaller this year. ATV's Allison Chan reports.
Spirits were high in Lan Kwai Fong last night as revelers celebrated Halloween by donning the most frightening costumes they could find. But when the party was over, students who were staging an ongoing pro-democracy protest in Admiralty next door came out to clean up the entertainment hub. They collected empty bottles and rubbish from the streets for recycling. Lan Kwai Fong was quieter than in previous Halloweens, and this was blamed on the mass sit-ins. Federation of Hong Kong Industries Chairman Stanley Lau told the radio show that the protests are having an adverse economic impact and warned that workers in the retail sector may not receive the 4% pay rise they expect next year. Lau said small shops and business around the protest zones have seen their turnovers plunge by between 30 and 70%. Michael Lee from the Federation of Hong Kong Hotel Owners said his industry is also feeling the pinch. Room reservations for October and November dropped by around 20%, and there were at least 1,000 cancellations every night. Many travelers keep asking whether Hong Kong is safe, Lee said. The hotel industry is expecting a bleak Christmas and New Year holiday season if the protests continue. Allison Chan, ATV News.
Taiwanese President Ma Ying-jeou says his support for Hong Kong's pro-democracy protesters will not be at the expense of better ties with the mainland.
And Hong Kong's last colonial governor has praised the Occupy demonstrations. And Chang reports.
In an interview with the New York Times, President Ma Ying-jeou of Taiwan again voiced support for the pro-democracy protesters in Hong Kong. But he stressed that the backing would not be at the expense of cross-strait relations. Ma also stressed his opposition to violence and urged the use of peaceful means to resolve disputes. The demonstrators in Hong Kong also received another boost from the last colonial governor, Chris Patten. Speaking at Oxford University, where he's chancellor, Patten said he's impressed by the dignity, decency, and seriousness of the protesters. He received a symbol of the umbrella movement and posed with it for photos. Patton also warned against leaders receiving bad advice from aides. He made the remark apparently in reference to controversial comments Chief Executive Leung Chun-ying made recently concerning the working class as well as the sports and religious sectors. Leung later expressed regret for the comments which triggered public outrage. Ann Chang, ATV News.
Space tourism has been dealt a severe blow after a passenger spaceship exploded during a test flight in California, killing one of the two pilots.
But British billionaire Richard Branson, who owned the spacecraft, said he'll not abandon his plan to take wealthy travelers to space.
Disaster struck moments after a suborbital passenger spaceship separated from the aircraft that took it high above the Mojave Desert in California for a test flight. Within seconds, the spaceship exploded, scattering debris over a wide area about 190 kilometers north of Los Angeles. One pilot was killed, while another who parachuted to the ground was found with serious injuries. The craft, dubbed Spaceship Two, suffered a serious anomaly, according to its owner, Virgin Galactic. Its chief executive described the crash as a painful loss for the space flight sector.
Space is hard. And today was a tough day. We are going to be supporting the investigation as we figure out what happened today. And we're going to get through it. Future rests in many ways on hard days like this.
British billionaire Richard Branson, who founded the company, was on his way to the crashed site. The Spaceship Two was designed to carry passengers about 100 kilometers above Earth, the beginning of outer space, letting them experience a few minutes of weightlessness and enjoy a bird's-eye view of the planet. Already 800 people have signed up for the space tours, at a cost of $250,000 each, which had been expected to begin next year. The crash was the second setback for the private space launch sector. On Tuesday, an unmanned rocket exploded 15 seconds after liftoff in the U.S. state of Virginia, destroying a cargo ship carrying supplies to the International Space Station.
There's confusion over who's in charge of Burkina Faso after the resignation of long-serving president.
But first, in a round of international news, a U.S. nurse forced into isolation due to fears about Ebola has won a legal battle to avoid quarantine restrictions. ATV's Ben O'Rourke reports.
As U.S. authorities step up their anti-Ebola measures, the focus is still on someone who doesn't even have the virus. Whoa. Nurse Casey Hickox, who threatened to sue after enduring forced isolation in New Jersey on her return from West Africa, has won a battle against strict quarantine rules in her home state of Maine. The court agreed that her movements do not need to be restricted since she shows no signs of being infected.
I know that Ebola is a scary disease. I have seen it face to face. And I know that we are nowhere near winning this battle. We will only win this battle as we continue this discussion, as we gain a better collective understanding about Ebola and public health, as we overcome the fear, and most importantly, as we end the outbreak that is still ongoing in West Africa today.
Meanwhile, an Oregon woman has been put in isolation in a Milwaukee hospital after arriving home from one of the Ebola-struck nations. Lieutenant Colonel Isaac Zida announced today that he is taking over as head of state in Burkina Faso. The announcement came just hours after Military Chief of Staff Honor Traor said he would lead a transitional government following the resignation yesterday of President Blaise Compaoré, who led the West African state for 27 years. Many of the tens of thousands of protesters who packed the streets of Ouagadougou yesterday rejected Traoré's announcement, saying he was too close to Compaoré for their liking. That statement is believed to have spurred on a group of junior officers led by Zida to take over the country. A convoy of Iraqi Kurds drove through Turkey overnight towards the Syrian border to help defend the town of Kobani from Islamic State militants. The force only numbers around 150, but they have weapons and ammunition. The town, defended by Syrian Kurds, is also being pummeled.